Hello and welcome to another World War II podcast. This episode is being released on the 15th of December, the eve of the Battle of the Bulge. It was the 16th of December 1944 that Hitler launched Operation Watch on the Rhine, the last great offensive in the West. Joining me today is Walter Zapotoczny, author of the 110th Hold the Ardennes. The 110th Infantry Regiment were part of the 28th Division, which bore the brunt of the German offensive in those first few days. But before we get started, I'd like to say a big thank you to all those listeners who this year have supported the podcast by becoming patrons. That small donation from a couple of hundred of you is really appreciated, and it does go to helping me to put the show together. Now, if you're not already a patron, but do enjoy the podcast twice a month and perhaps would like a little bit more World War II chat, I do make extras available, which I think the keen armchair historian might enjoy. So if you have a spare dollar, why not leave me a tip each month? Go to patreon.com/ww2podcast or ww2podcast.com and click on donate for details. So let's get cracking. The Battle of the Bulge has always held a fascination for me. I have very clear memories of cold, wintry afternoons watching the 1965 film on the TV. So, Walter, let's get started with the 110th. It's an infantry regiment, and I guess they must have shipped to Europe in 43?
Yes, they, I wrote in the book about a couple of the stops that they made along the way. They were in Camp Livingston and other places. They organized for deployment in at Fort Indiantown Gap in Pennsylvania, which is not too far from where I live right now. It was a loose ragtag organization, if you will, because at that time they were still building the U.S. Army. They were still fighting and training with wooden rifles. The discipline wasn't as great as it eventually needed to be. It became and was and needed to be and as, when they got to the Ardennes. You know, they have these farmers and mechanics and others that were drafted or joined, volunteered to join. They all came together. And I don't know that... At that time, they thought what they were going to face was anything near what they eventually did face, especially when they got into the Hertogen Forest and saw the what the Germans had were able to do against them. So, you know, eventually they got organized. They brought good trainers, better trainers in, and by the time they shipped to the UK, they were in decent fighting shape, I guess, for an army unit.
I couldn't believe when you point out in the book that they turned over 36,000 troops in 2 years before they'd even shipped.
Yeah, they did. That's amazing.
It's a testament to how big the American army was growing from nothing. Well, not you know, not nothing, but from real small. That's an astronomical amount of figures. I did wonder, which obviously is beyond the scope of this, but I did wonder how that affected sort of unit cohesion when you're cycling that many people through units.
Well, it did affect unit cohesion. There's no question about it. And I think I touched on a little bit in the book, but a lot of the leaders would come and go. And just as you tried to get the small unit groups to have some kind of cohesion, some kind of, esprit de corps, you know, the leader's gone or half of the group is gone. And so now you're starting all over again. And, you know, really that happened up until the time that they really got on the ships.
Mm. It's incredible. They hit France in 44, but they missed D-Day, don't they? Did they do much fighting in Normandy?
No, not much in Normandy. They did miss D-Day.
So they cover, is it 270 miles in 10 days?
Mm-hmm.
So that really is just sort of missing the Normandy, the Bocage fighting. And then they managed to take part in that victory march in Paris. So they're one of the units that... No, they used that victory march as a way of moving men across Paris, didn't they?
Yes, and it was really a way to satisfy de Gaulle and show that the American troops were there to support the French and, you know, we're going to fight on. And, of course, the French were part of that. It was interesting. I was in Paris in 2007 and found the park. It's now a soccer field, a couple soccer fields, where they actually bivouacked, camped before they went on that march down the Champs-Élysées. There are no signs marking anything, nothing. I happened to come across a lady walking a couple dogs, and I asked her what I was looking for. She said, "Oh, you mean where the 28th Division assembled?" I looked at her and said, how in the world do you know that? But she said, oh, it's right over there. It's right over there. And I went over there and there was a little plaque, maybe about, 6 inches by 10 inches in the ground that stated that. But you would have never, one would have never found it if you wouldn't. If I wouldn't run into her walking her dogs, I would have never known that.
How funny. I'm quite surprised that anyone put a plaque up to such a kind of a small thing of them bivouacking.
Yeah, there. Well, it was, it meant something to somebody at the time, you know, I don't know.
Yeah, well, that's marvelous. When I went over with my father, we couldn't find it. We struggled. We went over in 89. We struggled to find anything that he really could remember at all. even when he had a big story about how he'd stopped in a barn in a chateau, and we found the chateau, and he had to admit that in actual fact the chateau didn't look like anything he had in his memory.
Well, that's often the case, isn't it? Especially after so many years.
I think he was a bit disappointed because he'd been telling the story for forever. So from Paris, they're sent to the Hurtgen, and it's a real slog for the Americans. I'm sure not everyone will have heard about it. I wonder if you could, you know, briefly set the scene. You know, what did the 101st face there? How did they get 110th face there? How did they get on?
Well, they were sent up to relieve. I think it was the 9th Infantry Division who had fought up there, and they're on their way there, and they're seeing these soldiers coming back. They're dragging. They're beat up. They're dirty. They're carrying wounded. You know, they're awestruck by the whole thing. So they get there to that area, and they face a determined German force. And it was actually SS unit. A couple SS units were there. So they were very determined. And that was the first time they got their nose bloodied, if you will, in combat. And many of them didn't make it back.
Yeah, I mean, it's a real it's possibly not is it dissimilar to the Ardennes? It's all woodland fighting, wasn't it? I mean, I guess.
Yes, yes.
For many of the junior officers, it must be all those that survived must have been a sort of a good training ground, proving ground for them.
Well, if they made it through, it certainly was. They learned a lot. There's a painting hanging in the 20th Division headquarters building in Harrisburg that depicts the pause in the call trail, the pause of action, where both sides agreed that they would pause the fighting to remove the wounded. And the medics from each of the German and the 110th forces helped each other remove their wounded to their respective vehicles and you know, that they were going to bring the wounded back to their hospitals from. And it's a interesting when you look at it, and you look at the men, the amount of people that were just laying around and the destruction, for them to take that time to realize that, you know, we need to stop this for a little while and regroup and remove our wounded. And then they started the battle up again. You know, with the ferocity that they had when they first began it. And I thought it was an interesting, when one reflects on that, you know, so, you know, there was some pride and there was some honor among both at that time, even though the battle was fierce and the fighting was fierce.
It is fierce. I can't remember how long they were in the line for, but they do suffer horrendous casualties, don't they?
Yeah, they did. The losses were horrendous. They were there from, I think it was the 7th of November or the 6th of November through the 14th of November, and they were relieved. It probably felt like an eternity to them, of course.
I was going to say, it really isn't very long, to the point where they have to be pulled out to be obviously re-equipped, resupplied with fresh troops and re-equipped. And it amused me, you know, in retrospect, it has always amused me. It's ironic that they're pulled out to a quiet sector, which, you know, is the Ardennes, which with hindsight, is possibly the worst place to have put them.
Well, Eisenhower and Bradley felt that it was going to be a quiet sector. I mean, they never thought that the Germans would attack through the Ardennes. The Ardennes, as we know, are heavily forested. There just aren't a lot of good. There are only a few good roads. Those roads were defended. So there would be a good place to send a 28th to refit, to regroup, to lick their wounds, if you will. And that's what they did.
And it's funny as well. I mean, it's also a testament to how, I would say, short of manpower they were. They're not really, they're put back in the line straight away. They are given a sector to defend, a 15-mile sector. I mean, you know, how heavily, in theory, can they defend that sector?
Well, they were given a 9,000-foot front each of these groups. And doctrinally, that was probably three times the length of distance that they should have defended. And so what they realized is that they couldn't do a line defense in the traditional sense of, you know, putting so many soldiers along the line for certain miles, if you will, or and set up like you, like the doctrine, their infantry doctrine had told them to do. So what they decided to do was to set up strong points. They did that in the villages so that they could be resupplied. They had communication, they had road network, and they communicated with each other through observation points that were out in between these strong points and out further east towards the Ore River. And so that's how they were set up when Manteuffel started the assault on the 16th of December.
And are they fully, they're back to strength at that point, though, aren't they?
Not 100%, but they were getting back. They were getting refitted. They were getting close. They had new uniforms, equipment, and so on. But because they were assigned to a sector that it actually should have taken three or four infantry regiments to defend instead of one, they had to spread themselves pretty thin.
If you flip to the other side, if we look at the Germans, what's about to hit them, their operation is Operation Watch on the Rhine, isn't it? Which we all know as the Battle of the Bulge now. I mean, this plan did originate with Hitler. What is the plan?
Well, there were several variations of the plan. Hitler wanted to do what they eventually ended up doing, you know, attacking across the Ore River at various points and driving on through Bastogne to Antwerp to split the Allies, to destroy the Canadians and the British in the north, and buy more time. But he sent the plan. He got his leaders together, his military leaders, and asked them to look at the plan, see if there's any other alternatives. And they came back to him with several other alternatives because no one liked this plan. They thought it was suicidal. Well, round and round, they go back and forth, and eventually this was the plan because Hitler said that this is what we're going to do. And in fact, the field commanders didn't know what the actual plan was until less than a week before the plan was executed.
Incredible.
It is. It was kept in utmost secrecy. And so, of course, once they did get mobilized, they had the rail systems to mobilize, they had road networks there, and they start bringing these troops and organizing them. And we're talking about three army corps, and against the 28th, against the 110th position, you know, there's a couple pretty cracked divisions that are facing them across the Ore River. And, of course, you know, Americans didn't know this. They had no idea. They knew there was some activity going on, but they had no idea that this buildup was occurring.
How aware were the Germans of what faced them? Were they aware that they were facing green troops who were still re-equipping?
Yes, they were. They had infiltrated to the west of the Ore River. Every night they would send out patrols and scouts, and they would go to different regions, and they'd go further and further west. So they had a pretty good – Manteuffel had a pretty good handle on the lack of proper defense, if you will, that was facing them on the west side of the river.
And they pretty much come straight on at the the 28th Infantry Division is, you know, with the 110th is in the front line. You know, what's the first reaction when the, you know, that morning of the 16th of December, isn't it?
Yes. Well, it's 5 o'clock in the morning is when the thing kicked off, a little after five. When the Ardennes offensive kicked off. And so initial reports, the Germans were very good at sending advanced troops in and cutting communication lines. So the information that was coming back to the division headquarters in Wilts at the time was very spotty. They weren't sure if it was just some probing actions that was occurring. They really didn't understand the magnitude of the offensive that was coming. And so their initial reactions was, well, you know, just drive them back. Hold at all costs, drive them back. I mean, it can't be that much, you know. And then as the day went on, and they were able to reestablish some of the communication links. Most of the communications ended up being by radio at that point. They were relaying because the Germans, like I said, had done a good job of cutting the landlines. Once they began to realize the magnitude of it, There really wasn't much they can do. There really weren't any reinforcements close enough to support what they eventually began to see what was happening.
I hadn't really, because the story is, the lines get cut. I was really quite surprised at how well their radio network seemed to actually convey communications about. That was not part of the narrative of the Battle of the Bulge that I was aware of. Just seemed relatively effective when they got it all working.
Yes, it was. Of course, a lot of it's line of sight. It is line of sight at that time. So, you know, they had to do relays. They had relay stations. But there's a high enough terrain in Luxembourg that they were able to send it back. You know, as far as Belgium, into Belgium, actually. Wow.
So, and what these guys in the front line, the story, when you look at the story, and if you maybe watch the Battle of the Bulge film, is they're hit by the Germans and they crumble, they sent reeling. But in actual fact, it seems to be a lot of small, bitter fights, I guess, because they've, as you say, they've set up strong points rather than a line that aids this type of battle.
Yes, it really is. I don't think, you know, the movies that I've seen about the Battle of the Bulge and many of the stories that have been written concentrate mostly on what occurred in and around Bastogne. So, you know, they kind of fast forward from 16 December to the 19th or 18th when the Germans finally do reach Bastogne. What had happened was because the 110th and 111th, 112th as well in the north and south, you know, were set up with these strong points, it was truly squad level, platoon level actions, where it was small fighting units with a couple of heavy guns that were just taking on the Germans as they came. And the Germans were flabbergasted. I mean, they couldn't understand. They kept throwing men after him and men after him, men after him. And the leadership of the soldiers, of the officers in the 110th and the enlisted soldiers was tremendous. Their ability to fend off those attacks by crack troops was just unbelievable. And you just kept sending them and sending them and sending them. And they couldn't capture these strong points. Now, the amount of force that the Germans had, the amount of people, eventually, of course, overwhelmed it all. You know, there weren't enough people in these strong points and enough ammunition. A lot of it came down to running out of ammunition. They ran out of ammunition. They couldn't fight anymore.
But, I mean, it's incredible that they get to the point where they – and this seems to come up time again. They run out of ammunition to the point they've just got bags of grenades, and they carry on with the grenades. They don't. And is it first platoon that calls down the artillery on its own position?
Yeah. Now, you know, one has to think. When does that take? You know, you're out there. you could retreat, theoretically, and save yourself, but you call down artillery on your own position to hopefully to stop the invader. What mindset is that? You know, I mean, that's amazing. You know,
it is amazing. I did make a note. I had a note to myself, which I guess is unanswerable. That I wondered if green troops were a benefit, as they didn't know what to expect. They didn't know when to run.
That may be.
because I just found those stories, and they're incredible how they just held on and held on. Yet, Colonel Fuller, who's in charge of the 110th, it does request to withdraw, but that's, you know, that is denied. They are absolutely massively outgunned. Presumably, General Carter in Wilkes is aware. You know, why don't they, you know, allow them to pull back, or is it just a knee-jerk reaction just to hang in there and, you know, literally days go by?
I think it's the latter. And again, I don't know that the entire military leadership the whole way up to Eisenhower really understood the magnitude of this in the first couple of days of what they were facing. Hang on, you know, you're having some success beating them back. They're going to give up. Just hang in there. We're going to send you reinforcements. Hang on. I think was the attitude. Eventually, of course, you know, they couldn't hang on.
No, and you know, something else I noted that you know, I wondered if, you know, the Germans, their plan was to bypass strong points, but I wondered if the nature of the terrain made that impractical.
Well, it did, and there's a number of examples. But like in, for instance, Clairvaux, they had to come down the road into Clairvaux to get to the main highway. So, you know, you have to come through Clairvaux. And, of course, Clairvaux is a huge strong point, as were many of the other places as well. You know, there's only so many roads. And, you know, there's armor. And it's easier to run the armor on the road than it is trying to run through the forest. So, and trucks and motorcycles and everything else, you know. So they were somewhat limited by the road network available to them. And the Americans knew that. The infantry, 110th, 111th, 112th Infantry knew that. They needed to guard those strong points, those road networks, and set up the best defense they could along those.
At which point the Germans then get, you know, rather than bypassing, they get sucked in, which affects their timetable, because they're not bypassing and rushing ahead to the coast as they were expected to do.
That's right. They really did get sucked into it.
Something you bring out again in the book, which doesn't really ever get a mention very often, or certainly not in anything I've ever read, is the civilians. There's civilians caught up in it all. I mean, what do they do when, which way do you flee? I guess most of them would go west. But, you know, what do? Do they flee?
Well, some of them did, and many of them did. You know, they gathered up everything they could on carts and went west. Others decided, the Germans have been here before, and so have the Americans, and we'll just ride it out. Because we have to remember, the Americans went as far as the Ore River before. And so they had occupied that area. Of course, the Germans were there, you know, initially, and they drove them out. Americans drove them out. And so they'd occupied it. Now, so the villagers, you know, in many cases are looking at it and saying, well, okay, the Germans were here before. It was bad, but it wasn't that bad. Now the Americans are here. Okay, well, the Germans are coming back. Okay, we'll ride it out. You know, we'll hide our valuables as best we can. And, you know, we'll kind of ride it out, see what happens. And many of them just couldn't leave. I mean, there were people with handicaps. There were, you know, various reasons why they couldn't leave. But many of them certainly did, and they overwhelmed Wilts, by the way, further west, the refugees did.
I like the story of the guy who fled with his cattle but left his family.
Yeah. they'll get along okay, but we need to save the we need to save the cattle.
We need to save the cows. Get your priorities right. I wondered how many of them as well rued the fact they stayed, because some of these villages got a real pasting, and they must have just been... It must have been horrific cowering in the cellars as the battle swept backwards and forward over the top of them.
Yeah, I'm sure it was. And there were some accounts of that in that I put in the book, too. Houses are on fire, and, you know, from the artillery, both sides of artillery firing on them.
And something else, again, that the civilian accounts brought out, which is not something where they really ever get mentioned, is the use of horses by the Germany army. The civilians keep mentioning the, you know, the horses going by. I'd assumed, I know the Germany army ran on literally millions of horses, but I sort of assumed for this offensive that they'd scraped together, you know, everything the mechanical. I was quite surprised that so many horses seems to be referenced.
There were a lot of horses, and they did scrape a lot of what was available mechanically together. But we have to realize where most of the mechanical devices were fighting against the Russians, and so there's only so many they could scrape together. You know, they scraped together as many reserves as they could, but it wasn't enough. They still had to use horses and mules, donkeys, even though. A lot of the German units were mechanized artillery. Many of them were horse-drawn artillery. In fact, at this point, most of them were horse-drawn artillery.
Which I'm almost certain that but at this point in the war, we had almost no horses, the Allies, for it.
No, there were no, not that I'm aware of anyway.
No, exactly.
Maybe Patton's horse, I don't know.
Yes. Yeah. Why do I think he went? Didn't he have a Lipizzaner? Or am I wrong there?
I think he did. You think you're right? Yeah. In the movie, there's a scene of him riding in the inside stable. You know.
Yeah.
Indoor stable.
Maybe that's where I've got the idea of it from. It's not all. It's just constructed from the movie.
We have to be careful of those movies.
Well, they sort of seep in, and then you're not sure whether you've read it or you've seen it in a film, and then you start querying whether how true it is.
Well, Hollywood does take liberty, though. I mean, it's poetic license, I guess.
How long did the 110th offer some sort of effective resistance?
Well, from the 16th through the 18th, 19th, and it really started to crumble around that point. But for the first day or so, a couple days, it was pretty effective in many of the areas, to the point where, as you mentioned earlier, it threw the German timetable off enough that they never really did recoup from it. They never really did, because they should have been in Antwerp by the 19th or 20th.
That was my next question. How far had they expected to get but in that point in time?
Yeah, they should have, if they would have stayed to their plan, they should have been in Antwerp around the 20th. And, of course, that had been well in advance of the Allies being able to move the 110th or anyone else, any other unit, into Bastogne.
Well, and essentially what they do is allow for the preparation of Bastogne to, I guess, is the crucial thing that they managed to achieve by that holding up action. They create another backstop.
That is the key thing. Again, you know, as I try to point out in the book, if they wouldn't have done what they did, the 110th and others of the 28th, there's no question in my mind that the German forces would have overrun Bastogne with ease and marched. And after Bastogne, there was nothing there. There was nothing left. It would have been in Antwerp. They were unstoppable at that point.
When they're finally withdrawn, you know, how badly chewed up had they been? What was the final tally?
Many of the soldiers that were in the strong points never made it out. Many of them fought to the last man. A lot of them ended up being stragglers along the road, just trying to fall back. And many of them fell back into Bastogne and were reassigned to fight along the 101st and other units that were in Bastogne. The casualties were very high, extremely high.
It was quite incredible. They did survive as a unit. They carry on. I guess they must have re-equipped again, and they carry on into...
Yes, they do.
Germany later on.
But again, it took, here we go again, all green troops, you know. The point you were questioning earlier about whether the fact that there were green troops contributed to them not knowing to withdraw. We have to keep in mind that the leaders weren't green troops, though.
No, exactly.
Yeah, and they were the ones that were directing the action. So there was more to it than just being green. You know, it was this, we're not going to let them beat us.
Yeah. There's I once heard Max Hastings talk about courage, and he said, I feel that people have a sort of a well of courage, that once it's worn out, once it's used up, that they become less effective. At which point there's a sort of an optimum point of men in combat. You're not necessarily good at start, but somewhere once they've up to midpoint in, they're quite gung ho before they get quite cautious. They start to get more cautious as it goes on, and that's what I had in mind with the green troops. If they were still fresh enough to undertake what was asked of them, without necessarily thinking this is crazy.
Well, I'm sure many did, but they continued on anyway. I think when we look at the composition of the troops, though, many of these people had come through the Depression. They lost everything. They had to scrape and strive for whatever bit they did have. And the military provided them a way to get 3 square meals a day and make a little bit of money, provide for their family. You know, it's a different attitude. It was a different mindset. In the United States, we talk a lot about the great generation, the greatest generation. But many of these people were that greatest generation in the sense that they knew extreme hardship. They knew how to survive. And this is just another way to survive. And we weren't going to let the Germans win. One thing I don't know that you do know, if you have a few more minutes to talk, is that in 2000, I was a 20th Division historian up until the time I retired. And in 2008, the division commander sent me to Luxembourg and Belgium to do some research about some artifacts that the government of Luxembourg had who were trying to get back into the U.S. museum, you know. And along with that, I was doing some research about the 110th, and I met with these various historians that I describe in the first part of the book. And the thing that struck me the most, and I mentioned in the very first part of the book, was the small villages, when you go through them in Luxembourg and you see these shrines that commemorate the 28th, and well, not just the 28th division, other American divisions as well, but a lot of them, the 28th, Hosogen, Clairvaux, these little towns, they all have little memorials, and oftentimes they have the soldiers' names who died there. That struck me And part of the research that I was assigned to do was to try to provide some more information, maybe get some information from local historians that would support the appeal for another look at the award of the Presidential Unit Citation to the 110th Infantry. They never received it. Through a calamity of errors, you know, a lot of problems, they never got it. And we did that. We put another proposal together, and then I retired in 2009, and the guy took over after me, finished it up, and sent it in, and they denied it again. So here's a unit that fought so bravely, you know, and many died, but never, in many of our opinions, ever got the full recognition that they should have. And that's one of the reasons I wrote this book. Hopefully somebody will look at it and say, you know what, maybe they should do this. Maybe we should give them this award.
Do they give grounds for why they deny it?
Well, yeah, the main reason is that the unit did not fight as a unit. And I'm thinking to myself, well, of course they didn't fight as a unit, because you put them in an untenable situation. You made them break themselves up into sector fighting. I mean, come on, you know. And I think there's been some discussion along the lines. I mean, this is all, you know, people's opinions, but there's been so much made about the 101st Airborne that some of the people, at least after the war, did not want to take anything away from the 101st Airborne, and nor should they. I mean, 101st certainly did some tremendous things, and I don't think awarding them the Presidential Unit Citation in any way takes anything away from the 101st or any other unit who fought heroically in this campaign. I think what it does is it recognizes the achievements of this unit. And unfortunately, you know, we still can't get it done. So, and it probably won't happen.
Curiously, this is the second, my Christmas one last year was the Father Christmas in Wiltz, which was, again, I think the 28th Division, wasn't it? Are you aware of that story?
Yeah.
That was my Christmas one last year, which is another great story, again, which is still remembered, and they still do it every year with a guy dressed as Father Christmas arriving in a Jeep.
Yeah.
After all that time.
Have you been to Clairvaux in Luxembourg?
No.
If you get down that way, you should go and visit the castle and visit the museum. It's full. The museum is full, multiple levels, of 28th Division artifacts and memorabilia. It's just unbelievable the job that they've done and how they commemorated the 28th there.
It's the Battle of the Bulge to me is one of those things that as a kid I just thought the film and everything about it would just always, I don't like to use the word magical, but it struck a chord with my imagination, and it's always a place that I would like to go to, and I've never quite been. I've been around Normandy, and that's, you know, that's great, and as you said, this museum's stuffed with stuff that seems to have got forgotten and you know, tucked away in barns and things. But I'd like to have a look around the Ardennes. I've never quite got there.
It's interesting. I think you'll find it very interesting.
Well, I'll get there eventually. Well, Walter, thank you. Walter's book is The 110th Holds the Ardennes, The Blunting of Hitler's Last Gamble and the Invasion of the Reich. I will put a link on the website, www.podcast.com. It's a great book. It's full of some interesting stuff I had not read before, and I certainly found the look at civilians really good, really, really well worth reading. Just a quick reminder, you can also find me on Facebook. Do give the page a like. I try and post stuff that I hope you will find interesting and that helps illustrate each episode. If you have a spare dollar and enjoy the podcast, or even want to see what I look like, patreon.com/ww2podcast. So there we go for this year. Thank you to everyone who sent me an email, posted on the Facebook page, left a review on iTunes, and of course a big thank you to patrons of the show. So I guess I'll see you all in the new year. Wishing you a very Merry Christmas and a Happy New Year.